Good morning everyone, welcome to our channel Jit Ki Paathshala. Today we will see a lesson from history, that is lesson number 9, the rise of neo religious thoughts. So let's begin. Let us take a look at the pictures above. So here in picture 9.1, you can see three pictures which represents different kind of religious form. Aren't these pictures familiar images of various forms of worship and rituals men perform to please God? So here you can see different kind of practices which generally people perform to please God. These pictures show people praying to God by performing the Naam Kirtan, observing rituals and silently seeking God's blessing. So in these pictures, we can notice that people are performing Naam Kirtana or even they are worshipping God silently to take the God's blessing. This kind of devotion to God was a tradition of Bhakti and Sufi movements which began in India in the 8th century AD. And this kind of tradition was started during the 8th century AD. Now, we will see the evolution of religion in India. Prior to the rise of the Maurya dynasty, the people of India prayed to different gods and goddesses, animals, trees, etc. So before the growth of Maurya dynasty, the people of India, they prayed different gods and goddesses, even animals and trees. But when towns and cities came up, that means when towns and cities developed, trade and commerce, means business, also expanded and empires were established. So with the growth of town and cities, business also have extended. Similarly, a change also occurred in men's social and economic status. So when the development of towns and cities, trade and commerce took place, men's social and economic status also changed. People took up various occupations due to the expansion of trade and commerce, which made them prosperous. So with the expansion of trade and commerce, with the expansion of towns and cities, the people also took up different types of occupations. Different types of occupations means different types of activities, which developed their economic condition. These changes also affected the society as there was a conflict between old and new ideas. So this development brought changes between the old and the new thought and ideas. People found it difficult to accept old differences of caste and class in societies. So the developed people were not ready to accept the differences between the people on the basis of caste. The privileges enjoyed by the aristocracy, means those facilities which were given to the rich class of the people in the society, and the strict religion rituals and norms. And there was the strict condition, strict rules for the people who belongs to the low caste and communities. So with the expansion of trade and commerce, people were not ready to accept the old rules and regulation that existed in our society. So this resulted in a wave of new thinking that led to a revolution in social and religious belief. So as the people were not ready to accept the old tradition, old rituals that our society had, with this a wave of new thinking came out. And people started to bring some changes in the society. Many religious reformers, thinkers and philosophers preached their precepts and philosophy among them. Here precepts means moral values. So many social reformers, they even preached their moral values among the people. Among these, the teaching of Buddhists and Jains have attracted many people toward this religion. These two religions, means Buddhist and Jains, preached that one could attain salvation through following harsh discipline and self-control. Absolute devotion to God is the only way to attain salvation. Okay, so you should underline this one. And if you want to get salvation, that means moksha, in Hindi we call it moksha. If you want to attain salvation, then you have to be a true devotee toward the God. Okay, that means you have to sow, you have to sacrifice your life to the God to attain salvation. This message of the Bhagavata Gita had become very popular during this period. And this line actually was written in Bhagavata Gita, but in the later period, worships of gods and goddesses other than Shiva and Vishnu was also practiced. And at present in Hindu culture, there are many god and goddesses. The ritualistic worship prescribed in the Puranas had become popularized during this time, and the way of worshipping God which were mentioned in the Puranas got very popular during this period. However, the Puranas also accepted that God could be reached through devotion by everyone, and in Purana also it is written or mentioned that one can reach to the God. That means if you want to meet the God in your life, for that one you should be completely devotee toward the God. That means you have to sacrifice your life to the God. However, the Puranas also accepted the God could be reached through devotion by everyone, irrespective of caste or creed. And to reach God, there is not a particular caste or community which can reach to the God. Everyone, whether you may be a person from any community or caste, even though you can reach to the God, but for that, what you should do? You should sacrifice, you should be completely devotee toward the God. This unifying message of bhakti had become so popular that it was accepted by religions like Buddhism and Jainism too. So this unifying messages of bhakti had become so popular. That means to achieve God or to achieve salvation, a person should be completely devoted toward the God. It was so popular that even the people of Buddhist and Jain, they follow it. That means if you want to see God in your life, what you have to do? You have to be completely devotee. Completely devotee means you have to worship God with your pure heart, not only to show others. Okay? You have to worship God so deeply that you can connect your soul with the God. Now we'll see what is the bhakti movement, one of the important topics. So please remember this one. The term bhakti is explained in several ways. So if you have to write what is bhakti, then there are many definitions. Okay, but the best one is absolute devotion and faith in God is known as bhakti. So what is bhakti? Bhakti means you should be completely devoted toward the God, and you should also have faith in the God. Similarly, the reverence means in Hindi we call it shraddha. Okay, similarly, the reverence shown towards an elderly and honorable person is also regarded as bhakti. So not only the devotion that you show toward the God is bhakti, but if you show respect, if you show shraddha towards an elderly and respected person, it is also regarded as bhakti. Okay, but in exam, if you get the question that what do you mean by bhakti, then you should write absolute devotion and faith in God is called bhakti. In the history of Indian culture, the bhakti movement is regarded as one of the outstanding milestones. Okay, so in the history of India, Bhakti movement is regarded one of the important event. Bhakti is nothing but a state of the mind. Through the medium of Bhakti, the devotee surrenders himself or herself unquestioningly to God. So, Bhakti is a medium to reach the God where a devotee surrenders their life without asking any question to the God. We find the mention of the term Bhakti for the first time in the Upanishads of the Vedic literature. So for the first time, the word Bhakti had been used in the Upanishads. The union of human soul with a supreme God, man's love and devotion for God are some of the concepts which were dwelt upon by the saints. So some of the concepts which were developed by the saints are like union of human soul with the supreme God. That means you can connect your soul with the God. Next it is written man's love and devotion for God. The love toward the God. All these things were developed by saints. The tenets generally means principle or belief. The tenets which developed out of these thoughts came to be known as Bhaktism. And the principles which developed out of this kind of feelings, this kind of thoughts is known as Bhaktism. Okay, now let's see the next topic, which is the rise of Bhaktism. From the 7th century AD, two communities of South India's called the Alvars and Nayanars had tried to bring about a social change through Bhakti. So from the 7th century AD, two communities, especially in the southern part of India, which are known as Alvars and Nayanars, they tried to bring changes on their society by the means of Bhakti. That means they started or they took some initiative to create the devotion among the people toward the God. The Alvars were Vaishnavas and the Nayanars were Saivas. Okay, so the Alvars were basically the followers of Vaishnavas while the Nayanars were the followers of Saivas. The Alvars believed that Vishnu to be the Supreme God. Supreme God means the topmost God and the creator of the universe. They also think that Vishnu is the creator of entire universe who could be attained through Bhakti or through devotion. And they believe that if you want to meet Vishnu, then you should be a true devotee toward the God. According to them, God resided within man himself. Okay, according to them, they believe that God is within the man himself. God is within you, God is within me. This was according to the Alvars. And one could reach him through humility, devotion, kindness and love for all created beings. And if you want to meet God, then you should be very kind-hearted, you should be totally devotee, there should be love for others and for all the creatures. If you follow all this path, ultimately you can meet the God. In this way, the Alvars added a new philosophy to Indian cultures. So in this way, they put the culture that God is in every human being. They composed songs and poetry to take this message of Bhakti to the people. And they even composed song and poetry to take this message of Bhakti to the people. This trend of the Bhakti movement was found till the 11th century. Ramanuja was its chief patron. Here patron generally means a person who gives support for the growth of it. So Bhakti movement lasted up to 11th century and Ramanuja was the chief patron. Patron means you can even say guardian of Bhakti movement. At the same time in Kerala also a similar religious movement had begun under the leadership of Shankaracharya. So at the same time At the same time in Kerala, also a similar religious movement had begun under the leadership of Shankaracharya. So at the same time, some religious movement had also started in Kerala under the leadership of Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya believed in Advaitavad, the oneness of God and the human soul. And he believed in Advaitavad, which means oneness of God and the human soul. And Shankaracharya also believed that God can be found in a man. One could attain salvation through one's noble deeds and noble thoughts. This is the main philosophy behind Advaitavad. And this is the main philosophy of Advaitavad. You should see this point. Okay, what is Divya Prabandham? This is very important one. And you should follow this one. Okay, you should write this on your notebook. The songs and composition of the Alvars, which were in the oral form, were later published as written text, which is known as Divya Prabandham. So Divya Prabandham are generally those songs and composition which were composed by the Alvars. These were only in oral form. These didn't have any written form. But later they published these oral poems. But later they published those oral songs and composition, and that publication was known as Divya Prabandham. In this way, new thoughts of the Bhakti movement impacted the society and culture of medieval India and tried to bring about a religious and social transformation. So gradually the thought of the human being have changed because of the Bhakti movement. Bhakti was not simply regarded as devotion to God, but also as a medium through which the social evils could be eradicated and feeling of brotherhood developed among all groups of people. So bhaktism or bhakti simply cannot be regarded as a means to reach to the God, but it was also a means to remove the social evils that existed during that time in the society and to develop a feeling of brotherhood among the people. Bhakti began to be considered as a devotional activity by which the welfare of mankind could be achieved. Gradually, bhakti was regarded as an activity through which welfare of human being can be done. This new thought of medieval age became popular all over India, particularly in North and Northeast India. So this medieval India was faced with many challenges, which gave rise to many views and philosophies of the Bhakti movement. So that medieval India had faced many kind of challenges and problems. These thoughts and views in turn created a spiritual and intellectual awakening of the Hindu society. Although medieval India was facing many challenges, but these new thoughts had brought a lot of changes among the Hindu society. The strict rules and rituals of the Hindu religions, discriminations on the basis of high and low caste, rich and poor, etc., were some of the evils which had made the life of the ordinary man unbearable. As we know, during that time, there are many strict rules and regulations, rituals of the Hindu society. Even there was discriminations on the basis of high and low caste. That means on the basis of high or low caste, people were separated. All the people have not got equal importance in the society, as some of them were from some low caste. Even there was discriminations among the people on the basis of rich and poor. But because of that Bhakti movement, lots of these problems were removed. They wanted freedom from these evils. And those people who were facing problems because of these kind of rules and regulations, they wanted freedom from all these social evils. Although thinkers like Shankaracharya tried to show a way out of this, their philosophy was too high to understand for the common man. On the other hand, from the 9th century AD, the Muslim Turks and Afghan had begun to migrate to India and established their empires here. At the same time, some Islamic preachers also came to India from the Middle Asia and began to preach their religion under the patronage of the Sultan. And at the same time, some of the Muslims, religious reformer, they also came to India and they started to preach their religion. There is no elaborate ritual or ideal worship in Islam, and there is no ideal worshipping in Islam. Islams believe in only one God, Allah, and in the eyes of Allah, all are equal. This message of equality attracted the neglected and lower section of Hindus to Islam. As a result, the common people who were facing problem or who have not got equal respect in Hinduism, they started to take Islam religion. These events made many realize that there was an urgent need to reform the society as well as the Hindu religion. And when many Hindu people, they started to embrace or they started to accept the Islam religion, many realized that the Hindu religion and Hindu society should be reformed, should be reformist. There should be some changes in these religions and in the society. As a result, from 13th to 16th century, a socio-religious movement started in many parts of the country under the leadership of some thinkers, religious preachers and social reformers. So, from 13th to 16th century, many kind of religious movement started in India under the leadership of some thinkers and some of the preachers. These movements later came to be known as Bhakti movement, and these movement later on known as Bhakti movement. This movement was known as Bhakti movement because here basically some changes, some reforms were done in the society and in the religion. If you look at the map given on the side, you will know that person who started this movement and where it was started. So now if we see this map, we will understand that you can see here it was Guru Nanak, 15th to 16th century. Then if we go here, it is Ramdas, 17th century. Then Shankaracharya here, 8th century. If we go toward northeast, it was Shankardeva. So from this entire map, we can understand the different places and the name of the person who started the Bhakti movement. The fundamental idea behind the Bhakti movement is that there is only one God and He is omnipotent. Omnipotent means the most powerful, and omniscient. Omniscient means who knows everything. Okay? By praying to God devoutly, one can escape from the suffering to this world. And if you are facing any kind of problem, any kind of suffering in your life, then the best way to get rid of all these things is to worship God very heartily. God does not discriminate between rich and poor or high and low. God never makes any kind of discriminate among the people, whether a person may be rich or poor, whether a person may be from any kind of caste and community. God will treat always equally to each and everyone. God never makes any kind of discrimination. Like this reformist movement of Hinduism, a liberal movement had started in Islam also, which we know as Sufism. And we have seen that how some movement were started in Hinduism to bring some changes in Hindu society and Hindu religion, which we call Bhakti movement. Similarly, in Islam society also, there was a movement which is known as Sufism. Now, we will see the preachers of the new religious movement, Northwest India. In 13th century AD, in Maharashtra of Northwest India, a new trend of Bhakti movement was spread-headed by a religious preacher called Gyaneshwar or Gyandev. Remember this name? So, what we came to know here, that in 13th century in Maharashtra, the Bhakti movement was started by Gyaneshwar or Gyandev. Gyandev spread his teachings through songs and composition, and he spread his teachings through songs and different kinds of composition. He preached of a society which did not discriminate between rich or poor,
high or low caste and was based on equality, friendship and simplicity. So he preached that a society is a place where one should not discriminate whether he is rich or poor, high or low caste, and we have to promote friendship and simplicity. He told people that God was present in every man. He also believed that God is present in every human being. Gyandev's teachings were taken to different regions of Northwest India by his disciples like Namdev, Eknath, Tukaram and Ramdas. At least one name you have to remember. So Gyandev's teaching, whatever Gyandev had taught, these messages were spread into different parts of India by his disciples like Namdev, Eknath, Tukaram, Ramdas, etc. About this time, a similar movement was started in Gujarat, and at the same time in Gujarat and Rajasthan also, this kind of bhakti movement was started by Ravidas, Dadu Dayal and Mirabai. Mirabai expressed her devotion to Sri Krishna through bhajans which were popular among the people. So Mirabai expressed her devotion to Sri Krishna through her bhajans which were popular among peoples. In this way, she spread bhakti through her bhajan and kirtan which attracted many people to this movement. So basically Mirabai composed different kinds of bhajans and kirtan which are especially related with Sri Krishna, and this bhajan and kirtan had attracted many people toward this bhakti movement. So let's stop the class here. The next day we'll discuss the remaining part of the lesson. So thank you very much for watching the video.